Unfortunately, I'm going to have to respond to many unpleasant topics, but this is one that I see expressing itself in many ways, and if anything, it to me perfectly illustrates how, in many ways, we are failing in terms of how we care for the people who are victims of rape and other sexual crimes. Because I see a lot of people who basically take their victimhood on as almost a badge of honor and use that victimhood as an excuse to overgeneralize entire parts of the populace and decide that they have every right, have every reason to use their pain to hurt whomever comes across their path, whether this person is actually doing the things that is being talked about or not. And I dislike it because I've seen a lot of broken people in my time in research here on YouTube when dealing with the aftermath of sexual crimes. I'm not here to say that anybody who acts upon anybody against their will, be they adult, child, or otherwise, is somehow not to blame for their crimes. That has not been and never will be a position that I have taken in the past, present, or future. Rape is a horrible and can be a bit of a destructive crime, but unfortunately, when we got people like Dr. Drew Pinsky trying to state emphatically that if you ever get touched in your life, guess what? Your life is over. You have been ruined. Your soul has been destroyed. And yes, I do get that rape is very invasive, it's very intrusive, and it can be very destructive. But from my research, the ways we go about treating those who have been harmed by this particular crime is to further harm them through these types of therapies that we have going right now. Because just as some victims will treat the problem with a one-size-fits-all solution, the people treating them do the same thing. In other words, individuality is meaningless in the field of sexual abuse treatment, and this is very, very destructive on all sides. Because what my series found out is in prison populations of people who are rapists, especially child rapists, is that there was a percentage to which they weren't actually an active or a future threat to anyone, let alone kids. They've done maybe one crime, they got caught as they should have been and paid the price. 30% out of the remaining population out there, 30% were repairable, were not major threats, major danger to the population. They could become productive members of society. And to be honest with you, I don't think it's a judgment call that just because somebody has raped in the past, if they are willing to do the work and actually can show that they can show and can do never harming or raping another person in their lifetime, then they don't deserve a second chance. The moment they've crossed that line, that little rape line, suddenly they cease to be a person, and anything we do to them, including what Daniel Salsbeck, who is, it's public knowledge, so I don't think it's bad for me to say, he was a victim of sexual abuse, in his church, as or maybe I'm mixing up his story with a lot of other stories that I have heard, and of course. What happened to him was absolutely horrible and abhorrent, as well as the fact that I'm sure that he was one of many cases where people swept this sort of thing under the rug. But considering false rape convictions, false rape accusations as well into the mix, this whole idea of, well, if you're a man, we're going to chop off your dick if you ever dare to rape anybody. Do you think rapists really are scared about prison or being on the inside? Do you really think that this affects them to the point to where they this is a deterrent that stops them from raping? Do you think in societies where guys' dick does get chopped off when he is discovered as a rapist in the less misogynistic societies that are out there, and no, I'm not going to get into that statement any further at this point in time. Does it stop these people? No. This is like murder. You would think that, oh, if you kill somebody, we'll kill you back would be a deterrent. But the top three reasons why people murder never factor in the idea that they will ever get caught or that is not a concern, let alone the idea that being killed back stops them. So it's not just that this is extremely sadistic and mean-spirited to people who can be reformed. Even 60% beyond that had a higher rate of being able to be reformed and a reduced and reduce their amount of recidivism, if any recidivism. Only 5% of prison populations of sexual criminals are people who are so far gone, or so far in denial, or so far into their dysfunctions, because there's a spectrum of reasons why people rape, and usually sex has nothing to do with it. Forcing one's will onto somebody else has the most to do with it in most cases, but not everyone. Only 5% were found to be beyond any sort of ability to help them. And yet, no, we want to say that the moment you rape, you no longer cease to be a person, and especially because we're framing this in the framework that men are rapists. Because what punishment do we have for women? Oh, right, I forgot. How silly of me. Women are pure as the driven snow. They can't abuse, they can't rape, they can't abuse their spouses. Everything is men only. Men are so evil. Oh, God, I hate being a man. Oh, man, why did I have to be born a guy? Why do I have to have a dick that forces me to rape people? Because men are so rapey. But I implore people. I mean, most of Daniel's video has a point and a great point, but the moment that he starts to get that smirk on his face and say that he doesn't care how this will make him look, this is when I know. This is the kind of look that I have seen when I have talked to or interviewed different professional victims. Not that I'm saying Daniel is. I am saying, though, that he is using his victimhood as an excuse to pass judgment on an entire people. And I know you're saying to yourself, but they're rapists. What kind of use can they have? That's an individual basis. As I've said, 5% of rapists are completely beyond reproach. They are absolutely unreachable. You cannot fix them. But that leaves an entire bigger number that can be fixed, that can be taken care of, that can go and will willingly go through the therapies because they don't actually want to rape. To paint them all with a broad brush and to say that they deserve to be beaten, to be stabbed, to be cut in pieces. The most important part about this is advocating for this simply on the basis that you are a victim. How does that make you so much better than the people who you are condemning? The people who you are overgeneralizing, the people who you are creating this scenario in your head where anything and everything you ever do to them is just. Because they have crossed an imaginary line, and once they do that, they cease being human. Therefore, anything and everything we do to these people is completely okay because they're not people. They're inhuman. They're monsters. What they do, yes, that is inhuman. That is monstrous. Speaking of rapists, I agree. But then when you spend your life trying to advocate for the complete eradication of rapists and all this other stuff, that the moment somebody is found to have attempted rape or is a rapist, that they no longer have value to anybody, to anything, that they no longer are somebody's son, somebody's daughter, somebody's dad, somebody's mother, somebody's brother or sister, you name it. I don't agree with that. That is, oh, you're going to be inhuman by my standards. I'm going to be inhuman right back, and I'm justified because I got hurt. I'm sorry. And no, this isn't victim blaming. This is about trying to go through the realistic steps of looking at things at the bigger picture and saying, okay, somebody or somebody's hurt me, but that does not give me permission to then try to be a destructive agent, a destructive force, and think that I'm morally superior because I got hurt first. You see, because people care about people like you, Daniel. People care about people like you, the victims, until that victim then goes on, not that I'm saying you will, Daniel, I'm just saying, go with me on this, until the victim commits a rape themselves. Suddenly then, they're a monster. They're inhuman. Not only that, in these treatment programs that I've been talking about, oftentimes, as I've actually talked to some people who actually are doctors, who actually have gotten out of the field of treating sex abuse and sex abusers partly because of this. If you rape somebody just for the sake of argument, all that pain that you suffered, all of that molestation that you happened, you know what it's going to mean? Nothing. Because the system doesn't care about your pain, Daniel. The system doesn't care about you. It doesn't care about your pain. It doesn't care about that. In fact, they will not treat you for your sexual problems that you had in the past. Because, as they say in their manuals, that would give you an excuse for your rape. And you won't take responsibility for your rape. And then we wonder why, when some of these people are paroled, they might go and then rape again. Because we don't treat the symptoms. We don't treat the actual cause of the problems. We put them all into a box, and we make them fit into that. And when they then go on and they keep doing the same things over and over again, because we're ignoring the actual root cause of some of these rapists' reasons for raping, it's like we're saying, oh, you're a victim. I care about your pain until you hurt somebody else, and then I don't care about your pain anymore. Your pain is most important to me until you cross that imaginary rape line, and then your pain no longer matters. Can you understand now why this kind of victimization sort of thing, taking it on as your armor and saying, I have every right to say that everybody who I disagree with should be harmed in X, Y, or Z of a way? It would be far healthier for you to get yourself taken care of and then to move on from this, to advocate for the victims, but to realize that victims can become oppressors too. And suddenly, that pain that you've been carrying with you from your unfortunate and horrible molestations suddenly does not matter, and they're not going to treat you for that pain, because suddenly that pain is an excuse, and it is a crutch, and it is something that they don't want to deal with because they don't want to actually fix the problem of some of these rapists. You tell me if that's helpful to you, the victim. You tell me if that kind of mentality, that kind of way that we carry things, is helping the situation or hurting it. This is why I think better of you, Daniel. And I think that I would hope that you yourself would also think better of yourself and try to work towards fixing things rather than trying to get into sort of a barbaric, vengeance-crazed ideal that could very well overtake the rest of your life. I've seen it happen, and you wouldn't be the first that this would have happened to.